about learning is that no one can take it away from you. So, you should learn as much as we can.
We are privileged to have a bunch of us, Mr. S.K. Dutt, a senior HR professional.
May I now request Dr. G. Gopalakrishnan, Director, Balaji Institute of Management and Human Resource Development, to felicitate our guest with a bouquet of flowers.
Thank you, Abhishek. Good afternoon. On and off the dais, I, Subramalya Kundu, student manager, BIMM, takes immense pleasure to introduce amongst us a prodigious personality, our guest for today, Mr. S.K. Dutt, senior HR professional and international speaker. Sir has over 31 years of industrial experience in corporate, including an erstwhile subsidiary of Brookbond, a South Korean JV, and a Japanese MNC. Based out of India, several assignments of Mr. Dutt included responsibility of managing HR across international locations, worked as president and head HR in Praj Industries Limited. Prior to this, Mr. Dutt was working as president and head HR in ABG Group of Companies, ABG Shipyard Limited, ABG Cement Limited, and other group of companies. Previously, Mr. Dutt worked as head of HR TNB HED of Larsen & Toubro Limited, and prior to that as senior vice president, group HR and head in Wilsman Group of Companies. Mr. Dutt has also headed the corporate of SL Group of Companies, that is Z Television Network, SL Packaging, etc. Mr. Dutt was invited to the Summit of Human Capital Management as guest and subject matter expert by University of Chicago in May 2004 at Chicago, and also invited as a speaker at University of Alabama in Huntsville, USA in December 2004. Sir was invited as a speaker for various international forums, including Consult of Netherlands, Singapore HR Summit, and SHRM Annual Conference. He had guest speaker in invitation to speak a few reputed universities in New York and speak in annual conference of EI Institute in Texas during April 2016. Mr. Dutt has been visiting many premier institutes in India and abroad, and he is a Paul Harris Fellow of Rotary International. Sir, we are glad to have you over here amongst us today. May I now request you to enlighten us with your words of wisdom. Sir, the podium is all yours, sir. Thank you.
No, I think I'm good here, yeah? No. It's good. Good afternoon, friends. As always, extremely happy to be here amongst you all. My special thanks to Professor Bala, all the honorable faculty members, and to you all for having me this afternoon. I know that it's been two and a half taking lunch as the time, 2.5 days of great learning for you guys. And I also believe that what is, you know, like sort of standing between you and lunch is me. So, you know, like I can quite understand and relate to you know, the present situation. So what I'll do is I will make things extremely interactive, right? So some good news, because at times you can be lucky. There is no PPT. There is no download of heavy GYAN, right? So it's going to be extremely interactive. We are going to perhaps make things light by, you know, like discussing a little in terms of maybe the Euro Cup, right? Maybe a little bit about Muhammad Ali. Maybe a little bit about some movies and, you know, like some learnings from that. So, you know, like things will be good and much more interactive, and you would be, you know, like sort of looking forward to the lunch as well. And it would not be heavy on you. Before I start, I believe I was just inquiring about the theme of this conference, and I believe it is about, you know, like the changing paradigms of business or the evolving paradigms. Can one of you just sort of recount what exactly is the theme of this conference? Okay. Emerging? Okay, good. Now, in this emerging challenge, make this very interactive, right? So I'll, of course, be, you know, like sharing some of my perspectives, you know, like from the companies that I work, some of my own learnings. So don't think that, you know, like, I mean, Shubhro very kindly introduced me and said that he's going to enlighten. I'm not here to enlighten you. In fact, I have a selfish interest of the motive of getting enlightened by you all, because your perspectives are fresh perspectives, right? So it does not suffer from what we call as, you know, years of practice in the same way. So we guys need to unlearn more than learn, you know. So you are going to help me do that. So in terms of, you know, this theme, evolving challenges or emerging challenges in the business landscape, what is the most important factor, or which is the most important factor entity? What else? Something even more important than that. Time, innovation, attitude, all correct answers. Very good. Customers. Yes. One of you could actually note this down. See, like I said, I am not going to enlighten you. We are going to get enlightened collectively. So here is not all the source is everywhere, right? So one of you should. So culture and what else? Workforce, yes. Competition, right? I am seriously saying that all of this is right. And when I specifically add what I have in mind, all of you are going to agree as well. So everything that you have said until now is correct. What else? In some sense, that is the most important thing. Communication channel, right? What else? Beg your pardon? I didn't get you. Oh, values. Yes, yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Very important. Values is becoming fast one of the most important crux of everything in today's world, which is a great thing to happen. Professor, let me take these names as well. It helps, because if it is only S.K. Dutt who is saying, you may or may not take it very seriously. So when I'm able to take a few names as a validation, that may help a little more, right? Professor Ranjay Gulati, one of the senior most and fully tenured professors of Harvard, he's still serving as a fully tenured professor of Harvard, was speaking. Please stop me anytime to ask any question. As I said, this is an interactive session, right? So it is not a one-way process. So any query you have, just let me know, yeah? So he was talking in terms of leadership. And leadership is a very interesting topic. We all have our own views and opinions on leadership, right? And in fact, in terms of management literature, it has got one of the highest literature that you can think of in terms of leadership. So Professor Ranjay Gulati of Harvard said that there is one fundamental thing about leadership which is the most important. What is it? Which makes or breaks? Now, leadership also has the dimension of outcomes, purpose, goals, right? Leadership can't be in a void. So you have leader, you have a context, and you have followers, right? That's the very simple triad, okay? So you have a leader, you have a context or a purpose or a mission or a goal, and you have the followers. And the leader influences the followers, right? That's the very simple equation. The most important thing in that relationship for the leader is self, S-E-L-F. So what I was trying to get at, whether it is the emerging or evolving landscape or anything that you have got to do, is the word you, Y-O-U, in the context of leadership. Each one of you. Does this world exist without you? It doesn't. For each one of you, the very existence of this world is you. And I will bring it to the context of leadership as well. There is nothing in this world without you. So even in the context of business, when we say about business, about changing landscape, about emerging scenarios and all of that, it is you which is the most important. In terms of influencing outcomes, results, right? And the reason why I was talking about Renjay Gulati is that he says Harvard has done researches and world and some of the best institutions have done researches to show that this is the aspect which is the most difficult to handle. So one of the first lessons that we need to keep in our mind is that the moment, see, we all like, if you are asked a very simple question, do I want to be a leader? There would hardly be some, there can be somebody, because see, ambition differs. So I'm saying technically it is possible that somebody says that, no, I don't want to be the leader. But by and large, all of us would like to say, yes, I want to be a leader. Each one of us have the intent and the desire to be recognized as a leader. Each one of us have the intent to be recognized as a not only a performer, but a top performer. Each one of us want to be recognized as somebody who made a difference, right? Are you all agreeing with me? Each one of us, right? Now, when we do that, it is also shown by research and by history and empirical data that that is the most difficult aspect to handle. Unfortunately, I have a, you know, like this is a subject by itself, which is self-management and the you part of it and how results are directly driven by the you part of it, you know, in terms of that, because this is a subject in itself. But I'll give you only one example which Professor Renjay Gulati of Harvard gave, and that will make you understand why it is so difficult. And it is a very simple example, so there is nothing complex in that. And he very seriously said that how many times we have seriously made New Year resolutions? Umpteen times, right? Perhaps a few times we may or may not have, but most of the times we are unable to keep our New Year resolutions. Yeah? One of the finest examples, simple examples of failure of self-management, right? Now, I will come into the context of something very interesting. A few years back, we were having a panel discussion in Bangalore. I can't take the name of the company for the sake of the fact that it is a slightly critical this thing that I'm going to say. But you, I'll quickly touch upon the performance management issue and then I'll come on to something else. You guys are generally aware of a certain grade. So even if you have scored more than that and all of that, and you're like, and accordingly your increments are given and your promotions are decided and your career graph moves and things like that. And obviously this was not working beyond a point. And you know, like, I mean, even at that time, three, four years ago, everybody would say that no, especially for large organizations, that is something which is a must. So of course, I'm not saying I'm a visionary, but I said this from a very simple point of view, which is that at the end of the day, performance management or performance appraisal is all about motivating people. Any performance management that you do in any organization, when you are managing people, managing yourself, you need to feel great. You need to have the motivation to actually excel. You need to have the motivation to surpass yourself and achieve something which is even difficult to achieve, right? So anything by simple logic which puts you off, anything which demotivates you, anything which makes you sulk, anything which makes you complain, anything which makes you disengage from the organization is not going to help you to achieve what you have set out to achieve, right? So that was the simple thing. The point, the fundamental point in that also was that if you have achieved what you have achieved, independent of what statistics will force you into, you need to be recognized and given as reward what you have achieved, right? And that is why we saw that more sooner than later, this is not going to stay for long. Since the last about 7-8 months or possibly a year, you now find that Accenture has done away with, you know, force fit or what is more popularly known as a bell curve. Many of you have heard of the bell curve. So Accenture has done away with that. GE is the leader, sort of, you know, like it has always been, especially from Jack Welch's time. It has sort of in some way shown the way. So G is dispensing with that. G has gone a step further. I'm slightly digressing and then I'll come back to this. G has gone a step further. GE has, and this is also some of the shape of things to come. Although GE has not finally decided, it was there in the papers that there are good chances that they will not give increments annually. Right? Because you cannot have a situation where you are building on the fixed salary, and you guys would be very interested. I know, you know, like, I mean, in campus placements and everything, the first question is, pagar kitna milega? You know, like, what are your salary levels? So that's very understandable. But one of the shape of things to come for you guys that you should also know is that there will not be very soon, and there is already in some companies, a year-on-year fixed increase. The best fixed increase which will happen is, you know, like, a cost of living index adjustment kind of thing. But other than that, it is going to be purely on merit and the performance of the company, right? So what I'm trying to say is these things actually happened in terms of dispensing with a force fit or a bell curve, dispensing as much as, I mean, I was in the, you know, like HRPS, which is the Human Resource Planning Society of US last year. I must give you the other flip side as well, that they were also saying that many organizations which have dispensed with the bell curve have also reintroduced the bell curve. Because it has also, you know, like, given complications of a different kind. Because when you are handling, I should also give you the, you know, like, the other perspective of the story. So that is also a reality. Now, I will now giving you, like, how things are changing in terms of, you know, like, whether it is a year-on-year fixed annual increment, or, you know, like, whether it is a bell curve, or whether, you know, like, what is the shape of things to come, or how performance is managed as a whole. There is another very interesting facet that I will come to, which is, we all like to be top talents, right? In organizations, you know that, you know, like, there is a pool of top talents, top performers, people who are identified through assessment centers and through performances, high potentials. You generally know about that? Do you know? Yeah. So, you know, like, there is a pool of people in organizations who are identified as top performers on the basis of, you know, like, some assessments which happen, on the basis of their past performance, on the basis of the feedback of the supervisors, you know. And they are given special focus and concentration in terms of this thing, in terms of their career growth, in terms of even their salaries, in terms of their development and all of that, right? Now, here is possibly the next paradigm shift which is going to happen, which is what we call as the stars. And I will, you know, I'm not necessarily saying this is what it is, because there are things that need to be, you know, like, put forward to you for your perspectives and your thoughts. So this is more in terms of raising questions rather than saying this is what it is, right? So yesterday evening I was just jotting down a few points. I thought that, you know, like, I may not necessarily remember. And I mean, as much as I have general literacy on football, I may not have the complete literacy. But listen to this, and then I will have a few, you know, like, points of interaction with you as well. Most of you have seen or would be knowing about the Euro Cup finals which just happened. Very good. Now, I know that I'm getting into an interesting arena. In the finals of the European Championship in France in 2016, Cristiano Ronaldo, one of the two best players in the world, and one of the greatest players of all time, was injured early on in the match. You all know that, right? Very good. And had to be taken off. He broke down in tears and was shattered. Despite being taken off, he continued to motivate the Portugal players from the touchline. After Ronaldo was taken off, and we come to a very important piece here. Please focus in terms of what I just mentioned. Was taken off, nobody gave Portugal a chance. France had been the favorites to begin with, and Portugal's greatest ever player was lost so early in the game. You can understand the dynamics in the team. You know, like, I mean, if you would have read the papers in the run-up to the final as well, everybody said that the chance, the best chance for Portugal is Ronaldo, right? So compare this with the star player, the top talent, the identified top talent, the star who has been nurtured, everybody is banking on. In fact, even the team morale is completely revolving around this guy. You agree? Good. France had been the favorites to begin with, and Portugal's greatest ever player was lost so early in the game. Late in the game, he came in late, right? I mean, all of you who have watched would know. A player named Eder was brought on. Eder, however way you pronounce it, right? Was brought on. He had now, in terms of performance, is something else. Now, He had previously scored just 3 goals for Portugal in almost 30 appearances. How many? 3 goals for Portugal in 30 appearances. So you would rate the performance as what? It's surprising that he's playing in the team in the first place, right? Right? You agree? You need to be a little more vocal, 2 things, to make sure that you don't fall off to sleep and you can put off your hunger for a while more, right? All right. Okay, good. In almost 30 appearances, he had a below average record in club football as well. He had a below average record in club football. Hardly anyone outside of Portugal even knew his name. Very near the end of the match, you all know this, in extra time, he scored the winning goal for Portugal. And it wasn't just any goal. It was a special finish, you all have seen that, from well outside the box that beat one of the best goalkeepers in the world, Hugo Lloris, right? One of the best goals ever. Also, the other thing, I mean, this is an incidental thing, is that Portugal did not win a single match in 90 minutes until the semi-finals against the Wales. They drew all 3 of their group games and won the next 2 knockout fixtures in extra time and penalties. What does it tell us? Does it tell us something? This has something to do with you as well. My theme today is you. My today's theme is you in the emerging landscape of business, right? So my question is, what does this tell us, or at least point out to us? Beg your pardon? Yes, that is one aspect. Support the underdogs? Okay, in some sense, yes, agreed. Beg your pardon? Good point. When preparation, one of your friends, see, like I said, knowledge comes collectively, okay? So he said something, he said a wonderful thing. He said something which conferee in one of the largest conferences last year said, see, this is how knowledge rests. I'll revisit you. I mean, as much as all of you have made wonderful points, I wanted to specifically like sort of dive a little deeper on that, so that is why I'm saying that. Okay, what else? Sense of responsibility drives a person.
The war is not lost until it is finished.
Yes. It says one more thing, boss.
The performance level of the team increases
at but does it say one more thing? I'm not saying it does, but I'm asking you. Does it say one more thing? And I have a proposition to you all. Does it say that each one of you is a leader or can be a leader? Does it say anyone can be a leader? Does it say? Now, one or two of you have to tell me in the context of Eder and Ronaldo and Portugal, why does it say so? It's all about you, right? I mean, you would want to be interested in knowing how can you be a leader, so I'm asking you that. Why does it say in the context of this that it can be anyone? And past performance is no indication of future. I am actually breaking down or challenging, like I gave an example of, you know, bell curve business and how, see, our own, there is a very famous Indian management thinker, Athreya, right? A-T-H-R-E-Y-A. He has said that management thoughts always move in cycles. So it is very fashionable to say certain things, do certain things, and everybody has to be part of the flock. One more thing that I would say with the, you know, like the gray hair that I have gained over the years is don't conform for the sake of conformity. Have your individuality of thoughts. You know, Professor Bala always keeps telling me, ki yaar, jo bhi karo, jo bhi bolo, there should be takeaways for my people which they are able to apply in their lives. And that can only happen, you know, with folks like us when we are sharing our experience that we have learned over the years, you know. So the other thing which I'm saying is that it is very typical for people to say yes or do things which everybody is saying. You have to be different, but don't be different for the sake of being different. You need to have a reason for being different, right? Otherwise, you will look very jocular, to say the least. So you must have a damn good reason for being different, right? So my question to you is, in the context of Ronaldo and Eder, why is it that we say that anybody can be a leader and that past performance is not necessarily an indicator? Now see, there are so many theories that we are breaking in the process. We are breaking the theory of a Pareto principle which says that 20% of leadership drives the performance of the rest of the organization. I'm just saying 20% approximately, right? It is always the leadership that makes the difference. We say that, right? Guys, my apologies to this section. What happens is the way this is placed, I don't always remember to turn my head around to you all, but I'm as much addressing to you all as I am to anyone else, right? So my apologies for that. All right. So that's one. What else? The other thing that we are breaking is strong theories of behavioral event interviews. For those of you who know, it is great. Behavioral event interview, it is said, is one of the strongest predictors of performance. So in organizations, in assessment centers and everywhere else, BEI is done because it has the highest predictive validity. Okay? Now, and what is one of the fundamental beliefs of BEI? One of the fundamental beliefs of BEI is your past is your best predictor of future. Agreed? So insofar as Eder is concerned, if he had to undergo a BEI, what would have happened? He, bhai, selected to dur ki baat hai. Mera khayal se usko to thoda wo sharminda karke, usko embarrass karke bhej deta ki pagal tu yaar, 30 matchon mein zala 3 goal kiya pagal, idhar interview dena aaya kya? Knowing our mentality, agreed? Right, sir? But hamara performance management system ek aur cheez bolta hai. All of you are also comfortable with Hindi, na? But at times I think we should lapse into also a little bit of Rashtrabhasha that helps, right? So what I'm saying is, insofar as performance management is concerned, insofar as hard-nosed business promoters, CEOs, others are concerned, they say a very fashionable thing these days, which is almost a cowboy statement, which is what? Only results matter. Agreed? Ladies and gentlemen, only results matter. Only outcomes matter, right? So I'm saying what Eder did was what? Got them the Euro Cup, right? So my question to you all is how does it relate to two, three things? Breaking the concept that your past record has to be great, you have to be always a leader to be the next leader or to do great, that your past performance is always a great indicator or the most reliable indicator, and that leaders are already identified and chosen. In contrast, saying that it is actually each one of you who have the potential to be the leader. Right? Which basically says that it is the hour which produces the man. See, for those of you who know a little bit of theory, I'm not going into the trait theory of leadership or the contingency theory of leadership and all of that, situational, you forget that. I'm simply saying that is this right? So potentially each one of you can be the leader at any point in time, in any situation. Cut to, let me talk about the conferee thing, which I was just mentioning, and also in the context of your friend, and I would ask you to recount that. What you said is also right, but I'm just, you know, like specifically addressing that particular point, which was also said. Now, conferee last year there is a CHRO hub, which generally happens in their annual conferences. So last year the conference was in Vegas in US, and the conferee, one of the global talent heads, were making a presentation, which is a very interesting presentation. They said that, you know, like they were studying, you know, like there are these baseball teams in the US, right? And it is very, very popular. So they were like, we have this IPL, right? So they were trying to identify which are the teams which have got the trophy more than once, which are the teams which have got it once, which are the teams that have never got it. And also identify the players and see what is it that stands out in terms of this which leads to success, right? And each team had stars as well. Now, because I have said this, don't come back to me and say that, sir, it is not just stars, right? What was your belief? You think that who would have been making the major difference in the, normally what would you believe in each of these teams? Who are the people, who are the players who are making the most of the difference? The stars, right? Now, this research showed that it was actually not so. Interestingly, it was the second-rung leaders who were making the difference. What were some of the reasons for this? I am trying to dispel two things. Let me repeat this, because otherwise we can get lost in the discussion as well. I am trying to dispel the notion that only stars or top talents in organizations or institutes, very interestingly, like here is a dichotomy. The dichotomy is you need to try your best to do great results, right? Get the best of grades. But it also shows that going to the best school, Satya Nadella did not go to the best school, so to say, right? At least from India, where he did that. Going to the best school or having the best of result is not necessarily any guarantee of leadership and success in life. You agree? Right. So similarly, when we are talking in terms of, you know, like this, the leadership, organizations or institutions have the belief that it is always my star people, my identified performers, my consistent performers, my high potentials who are always doing the best. I am trying to say each one of you is a leader. That is the theme which I am propounding. Not to please you, but honestly to tell you that that is what the world is coming to. Right? What are some of the reasons for which the second rung and not necessarily the top players are making the difference in each of these? This was a very, very, see, Korn Ferry, many of you have heard the name of Korn Ferry, right? Korn Ferry has got one of the best leadership institutes globally, right? And their research is astounding. So this was one of the most extensive researches that they did. So what are some of the things for which you think this difference was happening? Yes, please. Very good, sir. So now put that into the context of these baseball teams.
No, no. The second one is aspirational leader. So he is in process of it. As in, he has started from the second star. The second star is in process of being the first star. So he is making sure all the criteria have been met.
Right, agreed. See, the other thing is, it is not any one. All of these reasons have actually gone into this. So what you are effectively saying is like that number two saying, there was an ad campaign, you know, where they said actually they put it in the campaign that we are number two, so we try harder. We are number two. So you are actually capitalizing on being number two and communicating to people we have no complacency. We are number two, so we try harder to please you, right? Similarly, what about these people who excel? Good point. So, there is always an advantage of the underdog, right? Like when India won the World Cup of cricket for the first time. What else?
Say the context of star players, the expectations are always higher. They need to perform and they are under pressure.
Agreed. Agreed. But you, I think you said something which was one of the biggest findings of Korn Ferry. So, please repeat, like I asked you to remember what you said. Please repeat. When preparation, one of your friends said this, and he touched on a discovery of Korn Ferry sitting here in Pune in Balaji, where it took an extensive research for them to do this. You know what they did? Fantastic. I think you deserve a round of applause for this, honestly. Honestly, great point. All of you deserve an applause, but this particular point is one of the best points, and I'll tell you why, because research showed this. What they would do, you see, in baseball, football, and in all of these games, high power, high voltage games, this is all split second decisions. The opportunity has to be transformed into a goal or whatever is the outcome in split second. So your skill has to be optimum. But along with your skill, there is something else which is working, which is what? Your mind. Remember the coordination. So what these guys would do is exactly what he said. They would anticipate the situations, the opportunities, and prepare for anticipated situations. Right? Yes. Repeat what you said.
When preparation meets opportunity.
You get the point? That is one of the biggest things. Because a star, once you label him as a star, I will give you an example. of one of the, because I should also relate to, you know, and I can't once again take the name of the company, in one of the largest companies, you know, like in the country that I was once working in, they had a very elaborate, talent management system where they would have, you know, assessment centers and all of that. And to cut a long story short, what they would do is, you know, like once they have identified, there would be, you know, a differential of pay between 10 to 40%. They'd be put on a fast career track, so their promotions would happen fast, typically, as it happens in many companies. But here, see how, when you are running an organization and in the context of organization behavior, it is important is that you cannot have a situation where you are motivating 20% and demotivating 80%. Does it work? Can you win a war where 20% of your generals are motivated, 80% of your foot soldiers are demotivated? Will you be able to win the war? However good strategy you have, you can't. So that is the other point which you must remember as well, in terms of, you know, like the motivation part, in terms of, you know, with this differentiation in terms of talent management. So these guys would actually anticipate, because they would have a chip on their shoulder saying that I am great. And this guy would say that, okay, you earn 40% more salary than me, go do it. So you are creating rifts by designing an organization structure or a reward system or a top talent system which is actually demotivating the larger part of your organization. So when you are doing organization management, all these things also, you know, like come in very as an important factor. Let me shift now, you know, like to how much, it's almost 2 o'clock, right? So how much time can I go on for? 10 minutes more? I think I should then cut short, right? All right. No, it's okay. Let me talk a little about Muhammad Ali. See, leadership has two facets, and you must very commonly know this. One facet is the cognitive intelligence, which is called the cerebral cortex, which is the IQ, and the other is the limbic system, which is the emotional intelligence, right? Now, I would have normally gone a little more elaborately in terms of explaining this to you, but at the moment we don't have time, so we'll cut short on that. You all have heard of Muhammad Ali, right? And have you also heard of George Foreman? He was also a world heavyweight champion. Now, many of you would also know, this I'm talking in the context of leadership, and I'm talking in the context of you, right? And what difference can you make to the emerging business landscape, so to say. Now, Muhammad Ali was drafted in the Vietnam War. So let's hear some stories of leadership, you know, preparation, skills, etc. Now, Muhammad Ali was drafted for the Vietnam War. Does anyone know whether he joined the Vietnam War or did not? Very good, very good. He did not, he refused. So to cut a long story short, when he refused, he was stripped of his title, right, of world championship title, and he was suspended for 3.5 years. Okay. Now, when he was suspended for 3.5 years, after that, when his suspension was revoked, he decided to fight again and come back to the ring. He lost to Joe Frazier. He lost to Joe Frazier, the previous Olympic champion, the world heavyweight champion, and a 3.5 year of rusting. Okay. George Foreman was 25 years old, 220 pounds in weight and pure muscle. And Ali was, of course, 32 years old and a bit rusted, right? So there was this championship which was fixed, and he had to actually come back and try and, try to get back the world heavyweight championship title. In 1974, 30th October, this bout happened. I recommend, because some of the things that I can't cover here, I would recommend to you so that you remember and you do it as part of your homework. If you guys want to learn any lesson of leadership which combines strategy and planning, because leadership is also strategy and planning. Because without strategy and planning, you cannot just be saying I'll be a leader and then do it, because you need to win. Leadership is also about winning. Winning how? By achieving your goals, by achieving your vision, your mission, your targets, your objectives, right? So if you want to have, and by the way, out of the 100 best sporting events in the world, which is recorded, this is the 7th best per se globally, right, in terms of this. And it stands out because of the strategy which Muhammad Ali used in winning, right? Now, the odds were against whom? The odds were against Muhammad Ali. Because not only was George Foreman the favorite, even in terms of physical structure, stature, weight, height, and his punch was such that they used to say that if he connects one punch, the guy would not get up again. So I would, of course, cut a long story short, but I strongly recommend that all of you must see with the commentary on YouTube this fight and must also read the literature in terms of what Muhammad Ali did as strategy, leadership strategy, how he changed his strategy, and how he prepared. It is one of the best lessons that you can ever learn. And this was a real life thing that happened. So very quickly, I will sort of run through. As much as there was no chance, for many months, Muhammad Ali practiced. So one of the things in your leadership lesson for you to be you as a leader is you need to practice. Like what your friend said, your preparation for your opportunity. And you should be able to anticipate. Your anticipation and your ability to anticipate is very, very important. So you would have, and there is this emotional intelligence part as well. So what he did, this fight had happened in Zaire, which is now Congo. And he physically went down there and he knew who the audience would be, you know. And because he would know who the audience would be, he actually would go out and meet them every day. So that on the day on which the event would happen, he would have the support of the audience, which was very important psychologically when you are getting bashed or punched by one of the world's heaviest heavyweight champions. Right? So the emotional intelligence of Ali was, he was just not depending on his preparation only for his physical prowess and ability. He was also connecting with people. And to be able to connect with people is something which is very, very important. Insofar as his tactics is concerned, he knew that as much as he can save his face, some of the hardest hit that he would take would be in his kidney and stomach region. So what he did was he made special preparations, all anticipation, leadership, winning. This is a direct connect of winning and leadership, because in leadership, you need to achieve your goals and win, no matter what. And combining strategy and planning with emotional intelligence. So I'm just giving you some excerpts of that, but please do, because these are cited in some of the best schools worldwide as well, whether it is a Harvard or an Oxford, right? So he did some of the hardest hits. Now there is a psychology bit as well. George Foreman was also practicing in a nearby this thing, and when he would pass every day, insofar as the punching bag is concerned, that is dented half. Look at the psychology. That is dented into half. So all of that hit on the day of reckoning would be on his tummy. Right? Because he knew that he can save his face, but he could otherwise not. Now, quick examples of strategy. When the day of the event happened, the first shift that he did was, there is something which is called a right move. I am not very familiar with this thing, but essentially what it meant was, it is an affront to professional boxers, where if somebody hits like that to a, you know, like a world champion, it is a crazy hit to be made. Technically it is allowed, but a crazy way, something which you would not anticipate you would do. Two things happened on that. First of all, it took George Foreman by surprise. So the element of surprise is very important in winning, right? What we call in warfare is psychology and stealth. You understand what is stealth? Where you go undetected. So your strategy must go undetected, right? So your stealth. So it was, and second thing is, it rattles you because you feel insulted that you look for at a world championship level, you are coming up with punches which are, you know, like sort of normally school kids would do. But it didn't matter. As long as it was technically allowed, it took him by surprise. He changed his strategy because Ali was very fast on his feet, right? So one of the things that George Foreman had done was to make sure that Ali does not have a route to escape. So every time that he would come out moving fast, he would block him. And here he did the masterpiece, which George Foreman himself had said afterwards. What Ali calls as the rope-a-dope. If you Google rope-a-dope, it is a world-famous thing. Which is what? Which is just leaning on the ropes. So he leaned on the ropes, and as a result, two, three things happened. It was a strategy which George Foreman could never anticipate. Right? It was a very elementary thing. Normally, people don't do that. But what is important for you is to win. So he was continuously leaning on the ropes. It happened for 8 rounds. And for almost the entire 8 rounds, he was leaning on the ropes. And George Foreman would throw wild punches. Pulling those punches sapped his energy, frustrated him completely, right? It completely sort of sapped his energy. It completely frustrated him. And all this while, he would psychologically play a warfare with him. He would say, hey, Barry, I was told that you can pull punches. Is that all that you got? George Foreman in his interview said, in the 5th or 6th round, when he put one of the hardest punches, he just went close to your ear and said, is that all that you got? Is that your best? Hey, if you watch that, and I recommend that you do in terms of strategy and preparation, you would know what a wonderful combination it was of emotional intelligence and strategy and planning. Of psychology, of skill, of tactics, of strategy. Ali actually changed his strategy because he himself realized that the way in which George Foreman was cutting him off, if he were to continue with that, he would run out of his energy fast. So the other thing in leadership is, you should be quick on your feet to realize when to change your strategy. Don't get wedded to your strategy. You should have not only contingency plans, you should be able to change your strategy fast, and you must have contingency plans and to be able to change, right? Because why am I giving this example as an example of leadership? I will tell you why. And I will read this out. This is one of the best quotations I've ever read in the context of leadership. And please note this. This is by Muhammad Ali. Champions aren't made in gyms. I'll repeat this. Champions aren't made in gyms. Champions are made from something they have deep inside them. A desire, a dream, a vision. The last part is the best, actually. They have to have the skill. You must have the skill. I mean, you need to be able to pull punches. And you need to be able to pull punches that matter. You need to be able to dodge punches. You need to be able to connect. Every punch that Ali threw connected well, almost all. And by the 8th round, Ali's face, as he says, remained as pretty as it could. He used to say, I have a pretty face, right? But the world champion, who everybody said was invincible, was looking completely bruised, completely rattled. On the 7th round, you would have a scene where he is unable to stand on his feet. This 220-pound guy with a menace which nobody could, you know, like sort of barely explain. The last sentence is this: they have to have the skill and the will. The willpower, right? Punchline, the last one. But the will must be stronger than the skill. It is one of the fundamentals of leadership. Your will to excel, your will to be able to make the difference, and your will to achieve has to surpass everything. The one thing, you know, like, I mean, I am a learner, you know, I mean, I've sort of, I keep learning across the globe, you know, like by virtue of my, you know, 3 decades of management practice and learning and all, I never gave up learning. So one of the things that stands out, you know, is this indomitable will. That's what makes the difference. Because without this, you know, it's very difficult. I would not go into detail. I know that, you know, like you guys would have, you know, must be feeling very hungry. But there is another homework, so to say, that I'll give you. In leadership, that is another 2 things are very, very important. One is, which is a fundamental of leadership, which is called influencing. You guys know that, right? So because I don't have time, I have changed my strategy. But at the same time, I have to meet my goal to make sure that you guys learn as well, right? It's important. Otherwise, I would have failed in my mission. right? Influencing, there is one thing which Peter Drucker said, which is, Peter Drucker, I believe, and the world believes, is the best management thinker ever to have been born. Nobody has surpassed him, right? Now, Peter Drucker said something very interesting, and you must know this, and I'm putting it in that context. He said that if you want to learn management, management in the broader context, as leading, right, to be able to lead, to be able to manage, you must go to an NGO. You know what is an NGO? Very good. Why did he say that? Why did Peter Drucker, the greatest ever in management, say, by the way, do you guys read Peter Drucker? Perhaps you would not be, because you'd be reading a little more of Jim Collins and all the modern thing. But I recommend, keep reading. Because the guru of gurus of management, even today, read him. And he has said the simplest of language. Because life and truth is about simplicity, not necessarily complexity, right? As much as we talk about ambiguity and complexity. So, he said, go to NGO. Why? Very good. What else? No, agreed. Good point. But what is one of the key differentiators in terms of challenge? Can you think of? Because you guys are so good. I mean, you've come up with wonderful answers. Self-motivation. What else?
Funding,
very good. What else?
Integrity.
Very good. All of these are right. I'm not saying good, 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 just to parrot it, but because these are actually right. But what is that one differentiator? When you, I'll give you a hint. Management control. So in the context of management control, what is that one differentiator in an NGO? Or a charity organization, let's say. Minimum resources, what else? There is, come. You. Great, that's it. No formal hierarchy, a big hand for him. To all of you who have come up with right answers, and also the answer that we were looking for. Very good. No hierarchy. Imagine a situation where you are, one, as a leader, it is the context, it is you, right? You have a situation where you need to influence outcomes without any authority. Is it difficult? Question, ladies and gentlemen. Is it easy or difficult to influence outcomes as a leader where you have no authority? Difficult, right? Almost impossible. 99% of them fail. Right? That is why Peter Drucker said that if you have to learn management, if you have to learn leadership, work in NGOs. Now, because I can't, carry on now further, like I said, two things, influencing, and there is one more thing, so I'll give you a homework. How many of you by any chance have seen a 1957 movie called 12 Angry Men? Wonderful. What you guys should do is make sure that you recommend to the others and ensure that you have seen that movie. It has been put on the archive of American Registrar for one of the best movies in the last 100 years to have been made. And once again, it is one of the movies that is shown for influencing in almost all the best B schools in the world. 12 Angry Men, right? Here, you should be able to understand it, and don't say it once, because you need to understand, because please remember one thing. Here is a shift from Peter Drucker, from my experience. You will come across 100 occasions in your life, which is not only limited to NGOs where you have to do influencing without authority. Because even when you have authority, you may not always be able to use your authority to be able to influence. And a good leader is he who is able to influence without being able to use authority. So it is one of the finest examples of how consensus building happens. How consensus is built without using authority. So read this. This is about a murder story where like 12 jurors have to agree on prosecuting or not prosecuting, holding guilty or not guilty, a person who's accused of murder. Okay, And even if one person disagrees, then you are not able to, you know, like prosecute the person. So to that extent, it was, you know, like they had to meet, and Henry Fonda disagrees, and how out of a ratio of 11:1, it turns into a 12/12, although all of them were in a hurry to conclude and just go away, happened, right? So this is one thing which I would recommend. One last YouTube thing that I would recommend is communication. Influencing and communication. Let me talk about another organization which I know of, which undertook with McKinsey one of the biggest change initiatives or transformation initiatives, right? Very surprisingly, have a situation where you want to achieve big goals. Is it possible where you are not able to convince the rank and file in terms of what they have to achieve? It will not be possible, right? So communication to that extent is very, very important. A small reference to Brexit. One of the fundamental, you all are aware generally of Brexit, right? The British exit from the European Union, a small reference. The reference is the people who are in favor of Brexit and people who are not in favor of Brexit. The people who are not in favor of Brexit would give out, roll out big data on economics and say why it will be a disaster for Britain to leave the European Union, and it would all be data, analytics, numbers saying that, you know, like this disaster would happen, that disaster would happen. The people for Britain to leave portrayed a very different picture. They said, boss, all your jobs are going to get taken away by this East European and other people. You would have a swamp of people who are going to, you know, like immigrate here. Your jobs are going to go. You are going to starve. Now, in terms of communication, another very important principle that you must always remember is it is not what you speak, but it is what, it is not what you say. It is what is heard. Always remember, one of the fundamental principles that you should carry lifelong is not what you have said, but what they have heard from you, right? And simplicity, there are some principles in terms of simplicity of communication. There are some principles in terms of, so one thing in terms of how to, you know, like communicate is another YouTube movie, which you, where you are talking about your, you know, like background, your communications, your generosity, being able to, you know, like find common causes, etc., is the lecture which Obama gave, the Ohio lecture, which is once again a milestone lecture. We will find this in the YouTube. See the full lecture on YouTube, which is the last lecture that he gave before his second term, which is called a classic lecture, which is one of the best lessons of communication. Right? So these are the couple of things also in the context of leadership, which is very important, which is influencing, and also communication. I'll keep it at this. One or two quick questions. I know that you must be feeling very hungry. And then we can break.
The house is now open for the questions. Good afternoon, sir. So the center.
Oh, sorry.
So my question is based on performance management systems. Mm-hmm. So so even if a lot of companies are doing away with the bell curve, there will still be a system wherein the business will identify your high performers and will reward them with.
You can say I'll be able to hear, yeah. I will actually claim to give you an answer which is a little futuristic, yeah? Because I like daring that way, right? On two, three silos, sit down, yeah? First and foremost, you know, like when we say doing away with a bell curve and all of that, and organizations still wanting to do that, I worked in a company, a quick answer. I know we all feel reasonably restless to head for lunch. I was working for a Japanese company. To cut a long story short, where we needed to set productivity norms, okay? And this was a company which had, of course, factories in Japan, it had factories in China, and it was setting up factory in India. And obviously, when setting up a productivity norms happens in terms of how much production should happen, how much, et cetera, you'd be looking at your headquarters in Japan. To my surprise, I found that as much as they were manifold ahead of us in terms of productivity, there were no written productivity norms. The point which I'm trying to make is the world will come to a stage where we are not, see, today, I know it is fashionable to say it is. Measured gets delivered, right? On creating a performance culture, right? Culture drives performance. So the example which I gave of the Japanese headquarters not having productivity norms and yet having higher productivity, you know, as much as we were trying to, you know, like set up productivity norms here with National Institute of Industrial Engineering, is in illustrating that point. So that is something which is very, very important. Once you are able to imbibe within people the hunger to achieve and the purpose to achieve, rest of it happens automatically. Something which you do for yourself, I mean, Tom Peters, you know, said this wonderful thing, that if people are so productive that when they go back home, I mean, in the American context, they said that, you know, like, they're either painting their home or doing something or fixing their TV or something. What is it that we do to them in the organizations which makes them so unproductive? So you have to kindle the fire here. You need to have structures and systems. The simplification of that is structures and systems are there to help you. They are not there to overtake you and make you mechanical. And in that context, reading that, you know, because I can't go into details, reading that McKinsey article on creating a performance culture will help you. Right? Shall we say thank you? Thank you. My pleasure. Thanks. Thank you all very much.
May I now request Dr. Archana Srivastav, Director in Charge, Balaji Institute of Modern Management, to present our guest with a token of love and appreciation.
Thank you guys, and all the best.